Good evening. I welcome you once again to virtual teaching. And today we are looking at the last group of people that came into contact with the Berbers. And basically we are looking at the Arabs. So the Berbers' relation with the Arabs. I hope you remember their relation with the Greeks, with the Phoenicians, with the Romans, and now we are on our last people, the Arabs. So as we do every day, I hope you can recall some of the impact that the Romans had on the Berbers as we discussed in our previous lessons. Today we are looking at the relations with the Arabs and its impact. So let's take a look at our lesson from Berbers as we move on. So as we do all the time, we should be able to describe the Berbers' relation with the Arabs and its impact on the Berber civilization. So how did the Arabs come into contact with the Berbers, and what were the effects of this contact? So that is basically what we are supposed to look at. So let's take a look at how the Arabs came into contact with the Berbers. Now after AD 50, the Roman Empire suffered great depopulation at home, which made it very difficult for them to employ people or soldiers to provide security and entrench their rule over North Africa. Now, well, the Romans by AD 50 had suffered depopulation as a result of war. And don't forget that the Romans were, they had stationed soldiers in North Africa, in their territory, in order to entrench their rule over the North Africans, so that should in case any rebel occurs, they can be able to quell it. Okay, but by AD 150, the Romans had suffered depopulation, probably because of war, and so they had lost most of their soldiers. So in view of this, what happened was that about 5,500 locally born sons of legionaries, okay, that's Roman soldiers stationed in North Africa. So the Roman soldiers who were stationed in North Africa were called the legions or the legionaries. Their children, about 5,500 of them, were employed by Rome to form the 3rd legion of Numidia and Mauritania for local defense. However, by the end of the 4th century AD, Rome hired a total of 22,500 Berbers to keep the peace in Numidia and Mauritania. So you realize that the 5,500 local-born legionaries whom the Romans employed to secure the North African area were not enough. Again, they recruited yet another 22,500 Berbers to, of course, keep the peace around Numidia and Mauritania. All these things, of course, the Romans were doing all this in order to still control North Africa. Now, by this period, the Roman Empire had become weak. This eventually led to the invasion of and the conquest of Africa by the Arabs in the 7th century AD. Now, Saudi Arabia, where Islam had begun, was also embarking on jihad, which they called the Holy War, and they were spreading Islam through war. And so when you look at how the Romans are even struggling to keep up with their military might, of course, they became weak in the 7th century when Arab started to spread the gospel or the Quran with the sword. And so following the invasion and conquest of North Africa, I think that North Africa became part of the Arab Empire, which stressed to the other part. Look at the map. Tell me, zoom for you to look at the map well. Now look at the map as you have seen it there. Now this is where we have Arabia. Okay, so this is Saudi Arabia as you have seen it here. Saudi Arabia, and you realize that Saudi Arabia is very close to North Africa. The whole of this place is North Africa, the coastal area of North Africa, the Maghrebian states. So this is Egypt. So you realize that they entered into Middle East here, then they also came into Egypt, then the Arabs spread through the whole of Africa, the whole of North Africa. They even went to Spain, as you can see it here. But later they were dragged away by the Jesuits. And
So Arab, of course, had, you know, and as you can see, that was the war. These were the Roman soldiers. The legends, and these were the Arab soldiers. Okay, so you realize that, of course, at this time, the Arabians or Arabs were very, very powerful. The Muslims were very, very, very powerful, and therefore they decided to take over North Africa. And that is how North Africa came to be under the Arab Empire from the Roman Empire. So let's take a look at the impact of the Arabs' impact. And after this, when Muslims or the Arabs, when they conquer you, surely you know what is at stake. Yes, I mean, you certainly know what is at stake. But let's take a look at some of the influence of the civilization of the Berber, the Arabs and the Berber. One was industrialization. So the Arab influence on the civilization of the Berbers extended to the economic field. As a couple of industries emerged in several areas, for example, paper mills were established in Tripoli, in Libya, and Fez in Morocco. Besides, they established other industries that manufactured pottery, metal products, soaps, and perfume. So the Arabs were very, very good industrialists. So they managed to establish some industries in North Africa. Example of such industries were the paper mills, the paper mills which were established in Tripoli, and Tripoli is in Libya today, Fez in Morocco. And besides the paper mill, they also established some industries like pottery, metal products, soaps, and perfumes. So those were some of the things that the Arabs brought into North Africa. So they came to industrialize North Africa, as you can see in the image there. Again, the Arabs brought to North Africa institutions of learning. You know, the Arabic education or Arabic culture comes with learning. Arabs are very, very learned people. So they brought with themselves institutions of learning where the Berbers could go and learn from. So another impact of the Arab contact with North Africa was in the area of education, yes? The Hafsid, a class of educated Berbers. So the Hafsid were a class of educated Berbers, encouraged learning in North Africa. Now what happened was that they established religious boarding schools called the madrasas, okay, or the madrasas all over North Africa at centers of learning. The madrasas was a state institution, and by AD 1400, they had established about 10 major ones in North Africa. The most famous madrasas was Al-Zaytuna in Tunis. So these madrasas were centers of learning. Today we will say Quranic schools, or we will say Makaranta. So these madrasas were centers of learning which were established in North Africa by the Muslims, and particularly the Hafsid, who were the educated elite, Berbers. Those were Berbers who had, you know, had some sort of education. They encouraged the North Africans to go into these religious boarding schools. And as you can see, that is the image there. Some of the image of the madrasas. Some of the image of the madrasas is what you have there. This was one of the madrasas, okay? And don't forget, they learned the Quran, as you can see there. So it's just some of these institutions of learning were also brought into North Africa by the Muslims. Quickly, let's move on to the other influence that the Arabs had on the Berbers. Again, the Arabs brought with them trade and commerce, and Arabs were particularly interested in trade. Now, Arab influence served as a catalyst to the growth and development of trade and commerce. It was during the period that merchants from Syria and Iraq began to arrive in North Africa to trade. And Syria and Iraq at this time had also been Islamized, okay, by the Arabs. And so their traders came to North Africa to trade because they realized that the North Africans had also been Islamized, okay. So prior to the
Islamization of North Africa, the Syrians and the Iraqis who were Islamic or who were Muslim, didn't want to come to the Roman territory. But when they realized that the Arabs had conquered North Africa, they began to come to North Africa to trade. So the Arab conquest served as a catalyst. It drew people to North Africa. And the Berber were exporting commodities like Syria, wool, and leather. And in turn, they would import jewelry, silk, spices, medicinal plants, metal ore, and perfumes. So these were some of the things that the Berbers were importing into their country. Now, the Muslims also introduced banking and finance to the Arabs. Prior to this, the Arabs did not know anything about banking or finance. And so, in particularly, banks which were in Baghdad, okay, and Baghdad, that is in Iraq, they set up branches in North Africa to promote financial ties, because they realized that, as I said, they realized that now the North Africans had been Islamized, so they are their own fellow people, unlike initially when they were under the Romans. Okay, and so banks in Baghdad, in Iraq, they came to establish some branches in North Africa to promote financial ties. So in no time, the introduction and the use of checks and letters of credit in parts of North Africa. So North Africans now began to use checks, that bank checks as you see in the picture, and letters of credit where they could get credit, you know, for their trading purposes. And so this boosted trading in the region. And you will agree with me that when they had access to these materials, checks, banks, you know, credit from the banks, the Berber traders were able to, you know, get enough capital in trading. And so it boosted their trading. Let's quickly look at the last two of the influence of Arabs on the civilization of the Berber. Now, the Arabs also introduced Islam and Arabic culture. Of course, Arabs will not conquer you without the introduction of Islam. And you realize that all the things we've talked about, you don't talk about Islam. Introduce Islam, which came with its Arabic culture. So Berber culture was influenced by the Arabs. So we realized that Arabic system of inheritance, marriage, and dressing were imitated by the Arabs. So Arabs, the North Africans, began to dress like the Arabs. And more so, their system of inheritance. In the Quran, it is stated the number of fraction percentage that each and everyone from your wife to your children should get. They are all stated in the Quran. So when you die, Qurans, Muslims, they don't write well. So when you die, the Quran stipulates that this is the amount of the percentage you should give to your first son. This is the percentage you should give to your second son. So Muslims don't write well. And that was copied by the Arabs. Their system of marriage, how they marry, the polygamous marriage. They are dressing, as you can see in the images over there. They are dressed like Arabians. Now, as the North Africans became Arabized, okay, and Islamized, they adopted Arabic language. And by the 13th and the 14th century, the Berbers had adopted the cultures of Arabs. So they had virtually adopted everything about the Arabians, their culture, their language, their dressing, their marriage system, their system of inheritance, their religion. And so in essence, we realize that the Arabs in Saudi Arabia and the Berbers were not different. They were almost the same people because they spoke the same Arabic language, dressed the same way. Similarly, you can say that with ourselves here, when the British and Christianity came to conquer us, we realize that our language we speak the British language, we read, of course, the Christian Bible. We read the Christian Bible. We wear the Christian clothes, or we wear the British clothes. Okay, so religion and culture are intertwined. You can't take culture out of religion. Okay, so that is how the Arabs dressed, but they refuse in religion. So you realize that, like as I'm saying here, we do the same thing. We wear the European dresses when we are going to church most often. We speak the European languages most often. We read the European Bibles or the Christian Bibles most often. So, in essence, what we are doing here is not different from what the Europeans are doing in Britain. Yes, but we are not British. But we have been Christianized, and because of that, we have also taken upon ourselves the British culture, their way of marrying, their system of inheritance, their dressing, and everything. We've also done the same thing. That is the same thing that the Berbers also went through. They were Islamized, and therefore they became Arabs, in quotes. Now the last one, and we bring our lesson to an end, was that the Arabs also introduced Islamic laws. Now this Islamic law is known as the Sharia law. Okay, all laws were fashioned in accordance with Islam holy law called the Sharia and the Hadith, the traditions of the Prophet. Now these laws actually regulated all judicial and political life of the people. So the Muslims have all their laws. You know, Islam is a complete religion. It takes up your whole life. There are laws in the Quran which stipulate that when somebody goes to steal, this is what should be done to the person. So they don't need any civil law whereby you go to court and blah blah blah. If you go to the court of the Muslims or Islamic, any Islamic country, if you go to their court, it is the Quran which is their constitution. The Quran becomes their constitution. The Sharia law takes over. And in the Sharia law, when you go and steal, for instance, I know that the Sharia law says that when one goes to steal, you should cut off your hand. The hand that you went to use to steal, you should cut it off so that you don't get a chance to steal anymore. I am not sure that any civil law, for instance, we go to our normal courts, that if you go and steal, we should cut off your hand. No, we will jail you. But if you go to any Islamic country and you steal, the law says you should cut off your hand. You understand? So these laws were introduced to the Berbers, and the Berbers adopted them. It's the same way that the Europeans also introduced some British laws over here. That if you go and steal, we shouldn't beat you, or we shouldn't sack you, or we should imprison you. Okay? That if you go and rape somebody's wife or take somebody's wife, in the olden days, they could banish you from the town. But the British said, no, don't banish, but rather take the person to court. Do that and do that. So you realize that there was this change, and that is basically the same thing which is happening here, the Sharia law. Now, it must be noted that Arab rule was greatly disliked by the Berbers because most of the Berbers were captured in war and became slaves. They also worked on the farming estates of the Berber ruling. So, eventually, you realize that Arab laws were not liked by most of the Berbers, because what happened was that Muslims in particular, they have this system. I don't want to go there, but of course they captured the Berbers in the course of the war, made them into slaves, and the Berbers were forced to accept everything about Islam, and they were also made to work in the estates of the Muslim sultanates and big men. So you realize that the Berbers did not actually enjoy the rule of the Muslims or the Arabs because they were made slaves. So basically these were some of the influence that the Arabs had on the Berbers. Good. Let's look at our questions. And they normally ask a lot of questions. WAEC normally asks a lot of questions on this topic. So in what way did the following people have an impact on the Berbers of North Africa? So this was an object. The Romans, the Arabs, talk about some of the impact. We'll talk about all of that. And the next one is about the Arabs. And then the next one too is about the Arabs. Then the last one, for impact, also is about the Arabs. And I hope you will be able to describe the impact whenever you are asked to do so. My number remains 0542083047. WhatsApp me with your questions and I will answer you. Have a good night. Bye.